So I think with this, we move on to the next session. Can I call upon the chairpersons to chair this session and take the proceedings further? By the way, we welcome Dr. Gambhir. He's here with us, so he'll be speaking in the next session. So Dr. Kasliwal, Dr. Vipul Roy, Dr. Vipul Roy is here. So Dr. Ankit, can I request you to come and chair this session? Dr. Pankaj is also here. Dr. Pankaj Manoria, can I request you to please come and proceed on to the next session and the proceedings of the next session? Dr. Ankit here, this side. Dr. Aarti Lal Chandani, is she around? Okay. And amongst the panelists, Dr. Subrat, Dr. Kuldeep, Dr. Prakash Pant, so please join.
So we start the session two, New Horizons in Clinical Cardiology. And I take the pleasure of inviting Professor D.S. Gambhir, a very eminent cardiologist, as well as a very, very eminent clinician. His topic is time to load all acute coronary syndrome patients with ticagrelor.
Thank you, Rajneesh, and thank you, Ankit. Well, friends, over the past five decades, we have understood the pathophysiology of acute coronary syndrome much better. And in fact, the data from the autopsy series, the histopathological specimens which have been obtained from the atherectomies of coronary arteries, and also from IVO studies, it is now very well known that patients of acute coronary syndrome develop their clinical symptomatology because of rupture of an unstable plaque. And this is followed by adhesion, activation, and aggregation of platelets, culminating into a partial, that subtotal, or a total occlusion of the coronary artery, which may ultimately translate into a non-STEMI or a ST elevation myocardial infarction. Meaning thereby that platelets play a very important role in the perpetuation of the pathophysiology of acute coronary syndrome. So therefore, no doubt that antiplatelet agents have become the cornerstone in the treatment of acute coronary syndrome. It has been clearly shown in several studies done several years ago that the in-hospital outcome is significantly improved by the usage of antiplatelet agents, both in STEMI as well as in non-STEMI. However, at the end of 6 months, there is no significant improvement in the mortality rates in patients of STEMI who have received an antiplatelet therapy. Currently, a large number of antiplatelets are available to us. Now, they have been classified based upon their mechanism of action. There are thromboxane A2 inhibitors such as aspirin. Then we have P2 vital inhibitors such as ticagrelor and the newer ones like prasugrel. GP2B3 inhibitors, and all of you know that there are three important GP2B3 inhibitors, and then PDE inhibitors. The aspirin has been used as a strong antiplatelet agent, and there is no doubt that aspirin in the several prospectively conducted studies for the primary prevention of cardiovascular events and subsequently a meta-analysis which appeared almost about 6 years ago showed that there is a 14% risk reduction in the various vascular events in individuals who received aspirin therapy. But this was at the cost of a significant increase in the risk of major as well as non-trivial bleeds. Now, aspirin has also been used in the secondary prevention of cardiovascular events, and the benefits of aspirin in secondary prevention, that means patients who already have either acute myocardial infarction or previously coronary artery disease diagnosed by coronary angiography or have undergone a bypass graft surgery, the beneficial effects are much more significant, and overall there is a 22% risk reduction in the various vascular events such as death, stroke, and myocardial infarction. The next drug to become available to us was clopidogrel, and clopidogrel, as you know, is a prodrug, and it is an irreversible inhibitor of the receptors, and the various trials have been done using clopidogrel. In acute coronary syndrome, there are a large number of trials in individuals who have acute myocardial infarction, unstable angina, previous myocardial infarction, or have undergone a PCI and stenting. Now, the data from various studies which have used clopidogrel along with aspirin and have compared this with aspirin have shown that there is a significant reduction in the various ischemic events, which means death, stroke, and myocardial infarction, when you use a combination of clopidogrel with aspirin as compared to aspirin alone. But the point to be emphasized here is that there is no significant reduction in mortality, and you can see here that the mortality reduction is rather insignificant. So this is the major limitation of clopidogrel. Now, besides this, now clopidogrel, as we all know, is a prodrug. Only 15% when given orally, only 15% of the drug is available for its action on the P2Y12 inhibitors. And not only that, it takes 6 to 8 hours for it to achieve its maximal effect after a loading dose of 600 milligram. Besides this, there are other limitations of clopidogrel, such as low level of inhibition of platelet aggregation. There's a large individual variability in response to the therapy. There is excessive bleeding during long-term therapy with clopidogrel, and it is an irreversible inhibitor of P2Y12 receptors. Therefore, when you have to stop clopidogrel, it takes about 7 days for the platelets to get activated and then stop bleeding. One of the most important limitations of clopidogrel is resistance to this clopidogrel therapy. There are a large number of studies done all over the world, and they have shown that total resistance to clopidogrel is encountered in almost about 5 to 10% of the patients, and about 25% of the individuals are poor responders to clopidogrel. Now, these leads to a higher incidence of stent thrombosis and therefore recurrent cardiovascular events. Amongst the newer antiplatelet agents, we have presugrel, which is a P2Y12 inhibitor, but it is a irreversible inhibitor of P2Y12 inhibitors, just like clopidogrel. The advantages of presugrel over clopidogrel is that it is a rapid onset of action, but it has also got a slow offset of action. Now, the efficacy of presugrel was evaluated in a double-blind randomized trial called TIMI-38. Now, in this trial, presugrel in a loading dose of 60 milligram and then followed by 10 milligram once a day was administered to patients, almost about 13,000 individuals of acute coronary syndrome, majority of whom had non-STEMI and about 25% also had STEMI. And all these patients were planned to undergo PCI. Now, the point to be emphasized here that the design of the trial was such that all these patients who were enrolled had to ultimately undergo a percutaneous coronary intervention. Now look at the results. The primary efficacy endpoint, which was a composite of death from cardiovascular causes, non-fatal MI and non-fatal stroke, was significantly lower in patients who were treated with presugrel as compared to those who received clopidogrel. But this was driven primarily from
the risk reduction in the non-fatal myocardial infarction, which was statistically significant. However, there was no significant difference in the death from cardiovascular causes, nor was there any significant difference in the incidence of non-fatal stroke. Now, although it is a beneficial drug, but the most important limitation of Prasugrel is the risk of bleeding. The major bleeding was significantly higher with Prasugrel as compared to clopidogrel, and this was for both the groups, whether the patient was treated by a CABG or in the non-CABG group. Similarly, life-threatening and fatal and other bleeds were significantly higher in patients who received Prasugrel as compared to clopidogrel. And a post-hoc analysis showed that Prasugrel was not as effective as or was not better than clopidogrel in individuals who had a prior history of stroke, whose age was more than 75 years or whose weight was less than 60 kg. So these are the three group of patients where Prasugrel is not advisable at all because it is not more beneficial than clopidogrel. Now lastly, we have a very important and potent antiplatelet agent called ticagrelor. Now, unlike the Prasugrel and clopidogrel, which are a pro-drug, ticagrelor is not a pro-drug. It has got a rapid onset of action because it bypasses its hepatic metabolism, and it has got a rapid offset of action as well. Now, the efficacy of ticagrelor was evaluated in a trial called PLATO study. Now, this study was much bigger than the TIMI-38 study. It enrolled almost about 18,000 patients, and all these patients had acute coronary syndrome, the non-STMI or STMI, and 28% of these patients were planned to undergo a medical treatment, and 72% of the patients underwent a coronary intervention, meaning thereby that this trial, unlike the previous TIMI-38 trial, also enrolled patients who had acute coronary syndrome but were not destined to undergo a PCI and were treated by medical treatment. Now, when we look at the results of the PLATO trial, there was significant reduction in the composite endpoint of death, myocardial infarction, and stroke, and this risk reduction was almost 16% and statistically significant. The drug was effective across the board, whether the patients underwent an invasive treatment, that is coronary intervention, or they underwent a medical treatment, whether the patient had a STEMI or they underwent a coronary artery bypass graft surgery or diabetes or renal. So across the board, the drug was more effective as compared to clopidogrel, and there was a risk reduction varying from 12 to 23% in various groups. Now, one of the most important advantage of ticagrelor is its effect on reducing the death mortality. No other drug till now, whether aspirin, clopidogrel, or prasugrel, has shown the reduction in the cardiovascular mortality. Whereas ticagrelor was the first drug to show that there was a significant reduction in the mortality in patients who received ticagrelor across the board. And this shows that the mortality reduction was seen in all group of patients, whether they underwent invasive treatment or they underwent a medical treatment or they underwent a PCI or a coronary artery bypass graft surgery. The drug was again very effective across the board in patients who had a prior history of stroke, diabetes, or had a chronic kidney disease, or even in elderly more than 75 years of age. This ticagrelor was also shown to reduce the risk of stent thrombosis, and this was statistically significant when compared to clopidogrel. When we look at the bleeding complications with ticagrelor, major bleeding was not significantly different when compared to clopidogrel, and other forms of bleeding were also not significantly different, except for intracranial bleeds were slightly higher with ticagrelor as compared to clopidogrel. CABG-related major bleeding were also not significantly different. The drug has also been followed up for its long-term efficacy, and there is a Sweetheart study where almost 45,000 patients had received one of the antiplatelet agents, 33,000 patients received clopidogrel, and about 12,000 patients received ticagrelor. And it was shown that even on long-term therapy, this was followed up for 24 months, unlike the previous trial where the follow-up was 12 months. Even on long-term follow-up, it was shown that patients who had ACS and undergone, irrespective of the treatment, PCI or medical treatment, there was a significant reduction in the risk of their subsequent ischemic events, without increasing the risk of bleeding, thereby suggesting that the drug is very effective even on long-term basis. Now we can skip one of these two slides. Now, the last part of my discussion is based upon the efficacy of ticagrelor when it is given before the patient even arrives in the hospital, that is in the ambulance. And there is a study which has shown that when ticagrelor is given in the ambulance and has compared the incidence of stent thrombosis in patients who have received ticagrelor after arriving in the hospital or in the cath lab. And it has shown that at 24 hours and at 30 days, both the timings, the risk of stent thrombosis was significantly lower when ticagrelor was given in the ambulance as compared to it was administered after admission in the hospital. Lastly, ticagrelor has also been shown that a crushed tablet achieves its levels which are as good or even better than when a tablet is given, and both at half an hour and 24 hours. So ladies and gentlemen, there is one drug which can be given across the board regardless of its diagnosis, unstable angina, non-ST elevation MI, ST elevation MI, regardless of treatment strategy, whether it's medical, PCR, CABG, regardless of history of stroke, age, weight, sex, and diabetes, etc. So when you talk of which drug should be given at the first medical contact when a patient arrives with acute coronary syndrome, well, the answer is very straightforward. Ticagrelor, yes. Prasugrel, certainly no, because there is no data to support that if a patient has to undergo a medical treatment, ticagrelor, prasugrel can be given. And clopidogrel can also be given, but in certainly low risk patients. So I just quote in the last two slides, what are the European guidelines? 2011 European guidelines for non-STEMI clearly showed that patients with AS should receive aspirin and one of the P2 vital inhibitors. Clopidogrel is recommended in patients who are not eligible for ticagrelor or prasugrel, and prasugrel is not recommended in patients who don't have to undergo a coronary intervention. Ticagrelor is strongly recommended in patients who have non-STEMI, particularly in those who have a high risk non-STEMI and are even pre-treated with clopidogrel, and the indication is class 1B. And similarly in STEMI, the drug has been found to be a 1B indication. So in summary, it is a ticagrelor is got a rapid onset and offset of action. It is universally effective, can be administered in all ACS patients. It is more effective than clopidogrel in reducing ischemic events. It is the only antiplatelet agent which has been shown to reduce overall mortality and cardiovascular deaths in ACS. Overall higher risk of major bleeding with prasugrel but not with ticagrelor. It's cost effective, can be given safely in patients with all ages. And lastly, it is a stoppage, it needs a stoppage only for 3 days prior to surgery, so it can be used as a bridging therapy for ACS who are planned for an early CABG. And certainly more effective than clopidogrel in ACS patients who are undergoing CABG. With that, I thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for the elaborative description of antiplatelet drugs. One question for you, sir. You have told the advantages of ticagrelor. In which subset of patient will you prefer prasugrel over ticagrelor?
In which group of patients?
You will prefer prasugrel over ticagrelor.
No, as I categorically told you that in patients of ACS who have to be managed medically, prasugrel has no scope because a trial has clearly shown that the prasugrel is not effective, and certainly in TIMI-38 they did not undergo a medical treatment. Now in patients who have to undergo a PCI, there is always a controversy whether prasugrel is more effective versus clopidogrel or vice versa. There is no head-to-head comparison, but when you look at the bleeding tendencies, bleeding is much more with prasugrel as compared to ticagrelor. So I would be playing safe with a patient who has to undergo a PCI. I would prefer to use ticagrelor rather than prasugrel. Number two, prasugrel can only be given on the cath table after looking at the anatomy. So that means you have to wait till the patient has undergone the angiography, and if the patient has to undergo angioplasty, then only you can give prasugrel. Whereas ticagrelor can be administered even in the ambulance, and thereafter patient can undergo angiography, and if he is a fit candidate for angioplasty, he can undergo angioplasty. If he is not a fit candidate for angioplasty, he can even undergo surgery, but with a much lower risk and better than clopidogrel.
Thank you.
And I think the prasugal should only be given in coronary interventions who are ACS. Yeah,
my question was, in which subject will prefer prasugal over ticagrelor? Or none of your patients?
We do prefer prasugal in some patients. For example, those who have got a diabetes, those patients who have come to us with a very large infarct, particularly in a previous stent, and the stent is thrombosed, for example, clopidogrel. So these are some of the patients where we do use prasugrel. But mind you, if a patient has received thrombolytic therapy, you should never give prasugrel because there is a very high risk of bleeding. Whereas in contrast, if a patient has received thrombolytic therapy and more than 24 hours have elapsed, you can still safely give ticagrelor.
Sir, and what is your take? There is one trial which was published in European Heart Journal recently. It was an open trial, open randomized control trial, in which they said that give a ticagrelor for a month and then give a maintenance of clopidogrel. So what is your take regarding duration of ticagrelor in such patients?
Well, I think, yes, this is a trial which has been recently published that in high-risk patients or in patients who have undergone angioplasty or in very high-risk patients, you can give ticagrelor for a period of 1 month and then switch on to a less-risk drug such as clopidogrel. The basis behind this trial was primarily because of a higher incidence of bleeding associated, particularly intracranial bleeding associated with ticagrelor. And therefore, it's not a bad idea that for first 1 month you can give ticagrelor, but subsequently you can give clopidogrel. But the downside of this is that the drug in another Swedish heart study, which is a registry, of course, of 45,000 patients and have followed up for 2 years and have shown that the drug is effective in reducing the relative risk of vascular events by 15% without any increasing the risk of major bleeding. Similarly, if you take out the plateau trial, 12 months, there has been no risk of increased bleeding. So I think the risk of bleeding is possibly over-exaggerated, so I don't think that one has to be really worried about. And cost factor, as I told you, that there has been a cost calculation about in terms of the dollars spent per year on using clopidogrel versus ticagrelor and prasugrel. And it has been shown that with clopidogrel, when the patient comes to us with stent thrombosis and you have to undergo a re-intervention, it offsets the cost benefit of clopidogrel, and therefore in long run, the two drugs, prasugrel and clopidogrel, are both more cost effective as compared to clopidogrel.
Thank you, sir.
So I have one question here. So undoubtedly, ticagrelor is the choice of antiplatelet nowadays. Undoubtedly, it's a drug of choice today. But what about the side effect? Because many patients, they complain of shortness of breath. So what's your take on this? Because the side effect of ticagrelor.
Well, I think I don't think that there are serious side effects of ticagrelor. The most common side effect of ticagrelor that we have encountered and which is also mentioned in the PLATO trial is breathlessness, dyspnea. It's in the trial, it is mentioned in about 14% of patients. I have seen in almost about 20% of the patients. But even in this trial also, if you reassure these patients and distinguish these patients that these are dyspnea or breathlessness because of drug and not because of going into LVF, you just reassure the patient that he might have to have off and on take deep breaths and it will tide over the situation. Then I think over a period of time, in about 1 month to 2 months, they start tolerating the drug and they can carry on. However, about 4 to 5% of the patients, they get so much of breathlessness that you have to withdraw the drug. And in such cases, you can always switch on to. Besides breathlessness, I don't think there is any serious bleeding, any serious side effect that we have come across, bradycardia or syncope or this and that. We have not seen as yet.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Gambhir.
I think we can have a big round of applause for Dr. Gambhir.
Now we move on to the second lecture, which is on managing patients on DAPT undergoing surgical procedure, traditional practice versus the BRIDGE trial. Now may I call upon the speaker, Dr. Rishi Gupta, to give his deliberation.
Good afternoon, chairpersons, my colleague. First and foremost, I would like to express my thanks to Dr. Rajneesh for giving me this opportunity. I'm going to talk on a very important topic about the non-cardiac surgery after drug-eluting stent implantation, how to manage the dual antiplatelets, especially after the BRIDGE trial. I think this is a very complex part, that you know that around 5% to 22% patients with PCI require surgical procedure within 12 months of PCI. You know that another important part also, that the many times that the patient being evaluated for non-cardiac surgery, and then you come to know that the patient is having critical coronary artery disease and has to undergo urgent angioplasty, and then you have to plan for non-cardiac surgery. Then again, you have to monitor the dual antiplatelet therapy for non-cardiac surgery. So these two issues has to be discussed. And why it is challenging? Because you know that once you put these patients and the patient is going for non-cardiac surgery, you have to discontinue dual antiplatelets. And once you are discontinuing dual antiplatelet, patient is at risk of developing stent thrombosis. And this is because of the reason that the drug-eluting stents are associated with delayed vascular healing. The risk of stent thrombosis because of the premature discontinuation of dual antiplatelets, then you have to always value what is the risk of discontinuing versus increased bleeding because of continuing antiplatelets in patients who are going for non-cardiac surgery. We also know that the surgical risk is inversely associated with the between time from stenting to surgery. So this is very important. If you are patient is going for non-cardiac surgery after a year of putting drug-eluting stents, then safely you can discontinue dual antiplatelets versus patients who recently had gone stenting. Within a month, the patient is at very high risk of developing stent thrombosis. We know now that the lot of data is now available. You have the new drug-eluting stents, which are modular, which are thin struts, and which are associated with very low risk of stent thrombosis. Now, safely with the available data, we can do the we can manage dual antiplatelets, and patient can have safely surgery after 3 months of putting drug-eluting stents. And now we know that the most of the time, more than 99% patients are going drug-eluting stents rather than going for bare metal stents. I think the previously we used to say that the patient who are planned for non-cardiac surgery should have bare metal stent, but this hypothesis has already gone. There is no more indication of putting bare metal stents in patients who are going for even patients who are planned for urgent non-cardiac surgery. And this MACE after surgery is because of the reason that this surgical procedure is associated with increased hypercoagulability, and it is associated with increased blood transfusions, increase in fluid shifts, hemodynamic derangement during surgery, and the most importantly, surgery is associated with inflammation and stress response which is responsible for increased platelet activation and stent thrombosis. And normally, the premature discontinuation is required to mitigate the hemorrhagic risk of operation. So this is a very complex part. So in my presentation, I would like to emphasize those important points which are required to manage non-cardiac surgery. You know that now, on one hand, you have increased risk of bleeding during non-cardiac surgery. On the other hand, discontinuation will lead to increase in ischemic episode or stent thrombosis. So this is a complex issue. And for deciding this part, I think there are three important parts which has to be discussed. One part, every patient is specific. You can't have the guidelines to treat every patient. There are so many clinical situations. What I can guide you, that what are the concepts on basis on which we plan the discontinuation
or management of dual antiplatelets. The first and foremost, I would like to state the duration of antiplatelet therapy, which has been shortened. As I said, that the newer generation of drug-eluting stents are safe. Now the ACC/AHA guidelines also indicate that all these patients can go for non-cardiac surgery after 6 months. They are safer from the first generation stents. The ACC already recommends that the stable ischemic heart disease, dual antiplatelet drugs can be discontinued after 6 months. Some stents, in fact, the BioFreedom trial have shown that the even after 1 month of dual antiplatelet therapy, even with acute coronary syndrome, patient can have non-cardiac surgery safely. And ESC guidelines also indicate that the dual antiplatelet therapy can be discontinued even after 3 months in special situations where the hemorrhagic risk is high. So these are the important trials which have been used, the SAR-SAFE trial, then you have the security trial, the optimized trials, then you have trials like the PRODIGY trial, ITALIC trial, which have documented that the short duration of dual antiplatelet therapy is effective, can be used without increasing the ischemic risk to the patient with without increasing the risk of ischemic episodes, with reducing the risk of bleeding. The other important part is the timing of surgery. There are no randomized trial to document that the at what time the patient is safe. As far as the non-cardiac surgery, the risk of surgery is concerned, there are many registries. The one of the registries is the Denmark Heart Registry, which showed that the increased perioperative risk is there till 30 days of PCI, and this disappeared after 30 days in new generation drug-eluting stents. Similarly, the US National Retrospective Cohort Study showed there is an increased perioperative risk till 6 months of PCI, but the risk was not dependent on stent type, whether it was a bare metal stent or drug-eluting stent, and after 6 months, it was not predictive of MACE. The Ontario Registry from Canada also said that the perioperative risk played huge after 180 days of PCI. The latest registry is from the Italian Real Registry, which showed that the whether you use the drug-eluting stents or bare metal stent, the coronary events or the MACE is same, and in fact, after the PCI, between 2 and 3 months, the drug-eluting stents had lower rates as compared to the bare metal stents. So the registry clearly gave the indication it is immaterial whether you put the bare metal stent or drug-eluting stents. What is more important that you have to have the duration, which is more important than the initial 1 month, it is strictly no. Patient will have a lot of chances of ischemic episodes if the dual drugs are discontinued. Between 2 and 3 months, the chances will be low, but still it will be high. After 3 months, in selected cases, you can discontinue the dual antiplatelets depending on the patient ischemic threshold. Because the ischemic threshold is also very important. All patients are not same. Many patients will have long stents, will have stents in the left main. Patient may have the stents in the bifurcation, may have multiple stents. In those situations, the patient is at risk of ischemic threshold, even though these patients may remain at high risk up to 12 months. So how to manage dual antiplatelets after DES? It is trade-off between the ischemic risk versus bleeding risk. It should be taken into account several factors. As I said, the timing from stent to surgery, type of stents which have been used, procedural complexity, ischemic risk of the patient, and bleeding risk of the operation. Not all operations have the same bleeding risk. So this is also important that you have to see that what type of operation is being performed. So this is one of the table which showed you the determinants of thrombotic risk. So you can see that the low thrombotic risk means that the patient who already had more than 4 weeks of POBA, more than 6 months of PCI with BMS, or more than 12 months of PCI with DES. So this is the ideal situation. This is low thrombotic risk. And the high, what is the high thrombotic risk? Means that if any patient is being operated between less than 1 month of PCI, is high thrombotic risk. and up from 1 to 3 months will be from up to 3 months of drug eluting stents is high thrombotic risk. Beyond between 3 and 12 months of PCI is intermediate risk. Similarly, then you have to see the what is the hemorrhagic risk of cardiac surgeries. The normally the low risk cardiac surgeries are the abdominal surgeries, the simple endoscopic procedures, the dental procedures, vascular surgeries, carotid endarterectomy, and the high surgeries are the surgeries which include the intracranial surgeries, the intraspinal surgeries, and transurethral resections, and intraocular surgeries. So these are important surgeries which are associated with high risk of bleeding. And besides this, hepatic resections and the bigger surgeries like prostatectomy, these are all high risk bleeding surgery. High risk bleeding surgery means that you have to be cautious about the antiplatelet drugs. So based on these two parts, we decide about the protocols of dual antiplatelets. The most important part to understand is the aspirin part. Most of the studies now indicate that do not discontinue aspirin in any of the patient who is going for non-cardiac surgery. And it has been seen that the surgery associated with, as I said, that the increased coagulability, increased platelet activation, and the studies have clearly indicated that if you stop aspirin, there is a high chance of ischemic episodes. And there is a lot of data which suggests that continuing aspirin during surgery do not increase bleeding significantly, while it reduces the event rate significantly, 60 to 70%, as compared to patients who are not given aspirin. Now, as far as the algorithms for treating these patients is, you can see this is a little busy slide, but it tells you if you combine the thrombotic risk as well as the hemorrhagic risk, so it tells you very clearly any patient who is a low thrombotic risk, then I think you can easily discontinue the second antiplatelet drug, you continue aspirin and get the patient operated without any trouble. When you, on the second hand, you have the patient who is a high thrombotic risk, means that the patient is being operated less than 3 months of procedure. In those patients, what you do, for example, if the patient is a low hemorrhagic risk, means that the patient requires the hemorrhagic from the surgeon point of view, the patient bleeding chance is low, then what you should you do? You can continue both the drugs, ask the surgeon to operate on both the drugs, let him continue the aspirin as well as the clopidogrel. In those situations, the ticagrelor and prasugrel is not recommended. In those situations, continue aspirin and clopidogrel, ask the patient to operate on these drugs. But suppose the patient is an intermediate bleeding risk or high risk bleeding risk, then what should you do? In those situations, what should you do? You should stop the continue aspirin, stop the second drug, clopidogrel or ticagrelor or whatever the patient is taking. After 2 days, give the bridge therapy with either congrelor. Congrelor is not available, unfortunately, in our country. Then you can give a short-acting 2B3 inhibitor like tiofibine, and then continue tiofibine after 48 hours, start tiofibine, continue for 2 days, and then stop 6 hours before surgery and get the patient operated. After operation, continue the tiofibine for next few hours till you have the loading of the antiplatelet. So this is the bridge trial, which I just wanted to mention. It is the Cangrelor, which is 2B, which is a P2Y12 intravenous inhibitor, which has the benefit of immediate, this slide tells you that Cangrelor has the immediate onset of action, which has a very short half-life of 3 to 5 minutes, and offset of action is within 1 hour. So this is one of the very important drugs which can be used in patients who are planned for non-cardiac or cardiac surgery, in patients who are already on, patient who are already had an stent in place and high risk, thrombotic risk. And yeah, just I think it will take few more minutes. I think it is not a very So this is the algorithm which I said that they stop the P2Y12 inhibitor for 48 hours, start the short-acting intravenous drug, give 48 hours, and discontinue, and then get the surgery done after 3 to 6 hours. And then after that, once the surgery is over, you can resume the antiplatelet drug after 4 to 6 hours and then continue. So this is the ACC AHA guidelines, which are, if you see from this picture, they are basically not evidence-based. These are based on expert guidelines. So you can see the class one guideline that the surgery should, after DES should always be elective non-cardiac surgery should be done after 6 months. The patients who are treated with dual antiplatelets, aspirin should always be continued. This is class one indication. So now remember one thing that the many times our surgeon is asking that they stop aspirin. So this aspirin stoppage is not required. It should be continued for all patients. It's a class one guideline. And consider class 2A means that you have to involve the surgeon for discussion about the continuation of antiplatelet on how to manage the antiplatelets or not. I already said to conclude that the elective surgical procedure should be postponed for at least 6 months after drug-eluting stent implantation. In some cases, it could be shortened up to 3 months. Selection of bare metal stent or drug-eluting stent no longer matter. Risk of surgery is very high if the patient is operated within 30 days of PCI with any type of stent. Between 2 months to 6 months of drug-eluting stent, the drug-eluting stent could be better than the bare metal stents. At least one antiplatelet drug to be continued, preferably aspirin, except in special situations, I said, intracranial surgery, intraspinal surgery, intraocular surgery, or TURP. Urgent surgery, if required within 3 months of drug-eluting stents in selective cases, then the bridge therapy could be considered with intravenous antiplatelet therapy, which is an acceptable mode of treatment. And the multidisciplinary approach, as I said, involving surgeon is important, and the starting the dual antiplatelets as early as possible after surgery. Thank you very much for your patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. For such an exhaustive lecture. I think we can take questions later on.
Yeah,
we should move to the next, and we can have a round
of... There's one question if it's allowed, when he wants to make a comment or a question.
One of my comment is that there is something called DAPT score that is called dual antiplatelet therapy score, which was given by the group from Mount Sinai, Ruxana Mehran. Would you like to make a comment on this? Because in this they have evaluated everything: type of stent, location of stents, number of stents, duration of the procedure, and what procedure you are contemplating to do. So I think the next ACC AHA guidelines when come for the regarding continuation of dual antiplatelet therapy, it will not be a blanket statement that it has to be given to all for 12 months. Taking consideration of all these things, they will tailor-made the duration of antiplatelet.
Yeah, correct. I think this is very, as I said, that the for a stable, this the short duration of antiplatelet therapy is only for the stable ischemic heart disease. For unstable heart disease or acute coronary syndrome, this is the, already you know that the dual antiplatelet therapy has to be given for 12 months. This score is what you are talking is only for one part, for the stable ischemic heart disease and for the low risk status. For example, what you have calculated, what when we say about the complex procedures, so naturally the short duration of antiplatelet therapy is not valid.
It takes into account everything. Whether the patient is ACS or non-ACS,
correct.
Type of stent, where the stents, so number of stents, whether it was left main intervention, bifurcation stenting. And this will, because with the newer generation of stents, the polymer is lost very early.
Correct.
And it is the polymer which causes most of the stent thrombosis. And your worries is basically for stent thrombosis, vis-a-vis a bleeding for a non-cardiac surgery. So I think it's a very exhaustive lecture. Thank you very much, Dr. Gupta, for your nice deliberation. So there is a change in the program. May I invite Dr. R.D. Yadav for the next lecture. So he is going to talk on triple therapy, dual antiplatelets plus anticoagulant in patients undergoing PCI with AFib.
Respected chairperson, dear friends, first of all, I want to thank Dr. Rajneesh Kapoor, who has given me some topic which is very, very much interesting for me. So let's triple therapy in a patient undergoing PCI. So what you will do, if patient is having coronary artery disease, undergoing PCI, and he also is having atrial fibrillation, either chronic or paroxysmal, who needs oral anticoagulant as well. What you will do, what the guideline says. So as you know, AF has a risk of stroke, and if you patient undergoes PCI, there is a risk of stent thrombosis if you will not give the dual antiplatelet therapy. So, and then I will tell about the use of DAPT along with warfarin or not, what the guideline says, and what is the role of NOACs in PCI with AF. So as you know, AF prevalence is quite high, and 20 to 30% of these patients are associated with coronary artery disease. And if you see, the coronary artery disease is also quite high incidence, and 5 to 7% of them are having atrial fibrillations. And in acute coronary syndrome, 2 to 21% of the patient is also associated with AFib. So you need both, oral anticoagulation along with the DAPT. But if you will combine that, then it will increase the bleeding risk. And particularly these combinations are required, particularly in atrial fibrillation, which I'm going to talk. But other conditions are like mechanical heart valves, venous thromboembolism, heart failure, LV thrombi, post-PCI or ACS patients requiring DAPT along with the oral anticoagulants. So you have to prevent a stroke, and you have to prevent stent thrombosis by giving DAPT. So what you will do? Triple therapy. What is the risk? Risk is that as you will, these patients, if you start these two drugs, the major adverse effects with the only antiplatelet is higher as compared to anticoagulants. So you have to give both. And if you will give both, the bleeding risk is higher as compared to only DAPT. So the same thing, bleeding risk is higher with the triple therapy. What is the guideline says? European guideline in ACS said that if the bleeding risk is low, you give first 6 months triple therapy. Whereas if bleeding risk is high, give triple therapy for first month and then dual therapy up to 1 year, up to 12 months, and then after only oral anticoagulation. In elective PCI, again, first month you give low risk or high risk triple therapy, and thereafter dual therapy for 6 months. If low risk of bleeding, if high risk of bleeding, first 6 months, and then after 1 year, you give only oral anticoagulation. So this is the guideline. This is the North American guideline. Is similar. He doesn't say anything about the DES. Let's what the data said. So as you know, why not to continue only aspirin and clopidogrel to prevent stroke in patient with atrial fibrillation who requires stenting? So you see, clopidogrel plus aspirin is not sufficient to prevent a stroke in patient of AF if he undergoing angioplasty with drug-eluting stents. So you need both. Oral anticoagulant is a must. And as the oral anticoagulant, along with the warfarin clopidogrel increases, the bleeding risk increases. So first trial, randomized trial, is the worst trial what to do in these kind of patients. And here is a relatively small trial where oral anticoagulant was combined with clopidogrel versus triple therapy. That is, oral anticoagulant warfarin plus 75 mg clopidogrel and 80 mg aspirin was used, and they were compared, what the results showed, that bleeding risk is the primary event rate, was significantly higher if you will use triple therapy as compared to clopidogrel plus warfarin therapy. So clearly, bleeding risk with the triple therapy is much, much higher, 44.9% versus 19.5%. And this, if you see, the ischemic event rate is also significantly lower with the clopidogrel plus warfarin as compared to triple therapy. So that's another beauty, along with the bleeding reduction. So worst trial, or even all-cause mortality rate was also lower if you use clopidogrel plus warfarin as compared to triple therapy. So clearly, this is the first trial which showed that in this kind of patient, what you have to do, use one of the antiplatelet drug, particularly clopidogrel, along with the warfarin, rather than triple therapy. That's the first trial which has showed something what you have to do in this kind of patients. Then another ISA triple trial came, and what it showed, that where to compare, since as in the previous lecture also, the bleeding risk
is higher with oral anticoagulants, so why not to give 6 weeks versus 6 months of triple therapy? And 6 weeks and 6 months triple therapy was compared, and what they showed that ischemic event, no difference between the two groups, but bleeding risk is higher. Bleeding risk is higher if you will use 6 months dose as compared to 6 weeks dose. So this is the ISAT triple trial. Now, data with the NOACs and with DAPT. What are the clinical evidences? First, let's see whether DAPT can be used in ACS or not. This is the topic of Dr. Vishal Rastogi. So I'm not going to just tell about only that APPRAISE 2 trial has shown that if you will use NOAC in ACS patients like apixaban, bleeding risk is higher and the trial has to be prematurely terminated. This will be discussed by Dr. Vishal, so I'm not going to say about detail about it. Then another trial is that is ATLAS ACS-TIMI 20, ACS-2 TIMI 51 trial, and it showed benefit, particularly of rivaroxaban 2.5 milligram BID versus placebo, and rivaroxaban 5 milligram. 5 milligram has higher bleeding risk. It showed benefit in all respects. Ischemic event is lower, stent thrombosis is lower, even mortality is lower, but at the risk of higher bleeding. But another trial of same drug was done by Gemini trial of rivaroxaban 2.5 milligram BID along with the P2Y12 inhibitor and aspirin, and so there is no benefit in terms of ischemic events, but bleeding event is higher. REDEEM trial in again ACS patients, here dabigatran was used, and what showed that if dabigatran was used in lower dose, bleeding risk is less. If used higher dose, bleeding risk is more. So the another trial of NOAC came is the Pioneer FPCI trial, and what it showed, there is three arm. One is rivaroxaban 15 milligram OD plus clopidogrel 75 milligram OD. Another arm is rivaroxaban 2.5 milligram BID along with DAP, and third arm is the triple therapy where vitamin K antagonist was used with target INR 2 to 3 and clopidogrel 75 milligram, aspirin less than 100 milligram. And these three were compared, and what it showed that rivaroxaban 15 milligram plus clopidogrel is better as compared to vitamin K antagonist plus DAPT. Again, also rivaroxaban 2.5 milligram twice daily plus DAPT is also superior in terms of bleeding risk. Bleeding risk is lower as compared to triple therapy, and ischemic events no difference between the two. So what you need is the lower bleeding risk. So another trial. Now, these are the trials which we are undergoing, out of which REDUAL PCI is published just last month, and Augustus trial is already undergoing. INTEREST AF PCI with idoxaban is already undergoing, and out of which this REDUAL PCI is already published. So I am going to talk about this REDUAL PCI trial, which again, similarly, it was compared by using the dabigatran 150 milligram twice daily with P2Y12 inhibitor, dabigatran 110 milligram twice daily with P2Y12 inhibitor versus triple therapy. And over 14 months of, this is a dose adjustment. If the age is more than 80 years or weight is less than 60, then the some dose adjustment has been done. Whatever it is, what it showed is clearly a result that if you will use warfarin triple therapy, the bleeding risk is higher. ISTH major bleeding risk is higher as compared to dabigatran 110 milligram plus dual therapy. Then warfarin triple therapy versus dabigatran 150 milligram dual therapy again is better than the warfarin triple therapy, but is still higher than that of the bleeding risk is higher than that of the 110 milligram dabigatran. So clearly, ISTH major clinical relevant non-major bleeding, as you see, the absolute relative risk reduction is 11.5% with 110 milligram dabigatran along with DAPT. Whereas in DAPT, what they have used, that first 3 months, they have used aspirin along with the clopidogrel. Whereas in here also ticagrelor was also used and found to be equally good, no increase in bleeding risk. Whereas if you will use higher dose of dabigatran, like 150 milligram, the relative risk reduction of bleeding is only 5.5% as compared to triple therapy. So first 3 months you have to use all the three drugs. And as you see, ISTH major bleeding was significantly reduced, absolute risk down 4.2% with the 110 milligram dabigatran and 2.8% with the 150 milligram dabigatran. Major and minor bleeding together was also significantly lower with the 110 milligram dabigatran than with the 150 milligram dabigatran twice daily. Intracranial hemorrhage is significantly lower in both the 110 and 150 milligram dabigatran rather than your warfarin triple therapy. But if you see the ischemic event, there is no difference. Ischemic event is equally in both the arms. So only one thing is that trained to be higher MI in patient if where dabigatran was used as compared to triple therapy. So conclusion of this trial was that dual therapy with dabigatran and P2Y12 antagonist significantly reduced the risk of bleeding versus warfarin triple therapy. And absolute risk reduction with dabigatran dual therapy were 11.5% with 110 milligram and 5.5% with the 150 milligram. So that is the evidence, and this is published last month, end of the last month in NEJM, and clearly showed that if you want to use dabigatran, use 110 milligram along with the dual antiplatelet therapy first three months, and after that you use clopidogrel along with the dabigatran 110 milligram. So conclusion is AF in patient needing PCI is increasing risk of bleeding due to DAP as well as warfarin. Only DAP is not sufficient to prevent stroke. Either warfarin or NOCS are must to prevent stroke. Current evidence suggests warfarin with clopidogrel 1 year, then warfarin only. As per OS trial, rivaroxaban 15 milligram with clopidogrel or rivaroxaban 2.5 milligram BID with DAP as compared as it is evidence in trial, that is called Pioneer PCI, and then dabigatran 110 milligram twice daily with clopidogrel or ticagrelor with aspirin 75 milligram for first 3 months, and thereafter only clopidogrel or ticagrelor plus dabigatran for 1 year, and thereafter only oral anticoagulation. So this is based on redual PCI trial. This is the what evidence based medicine said. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So what's the take-home message? Suppose a patient who has undergone a PCI 1 month back develops natural fibrillation. So what will be your antithrombotic regime?
You see, if the patient can't
just
afford...
Just tell me the regime. Affordability is not an issue.
Yeah. If patient can't able to afford the NOACs, I will give warfarin along with clopidogrel.
You mean to you omitting aspirin will be safer?
Yes, yes.
That's the message.
Based on West trial. If he can afford, I will combine rivaroxaban 15 milligram along with the clopidogrel. Or rivaroxaban 2.5 milligram twice daily along with the clopidogrel.
You will not apply the redual PCI strategy.
And aspirin. Clopidogrel and aspirin. Or newer, if you will say newer data, then redual PCI based, then dabigatran.
Plus P2Y2 inhibitor. Why not give dabigatran 110 milligram twice daily plus a P2Y2 inhibitor only?
No, dabigatran 110 milligram twice daily.
That's why
along
plus
with the
P2Y2.
First three months aspirin also needed, and thereafter you need only clopidogrel and dabigatran.
But
based on redual PCI trial.
But sir, your concluding slides have told that it is dabigatran which is more beneficial than warfarin. Hello.
As per the last slides that you showed.
Now
we have data with dabigatran. Otherwise,
now we have a data with
dabigatran.
The question is, how many patients of these who had chronic AF or those who have AF after PCI?
They have either a paroxysmal AF or chronic AF or persistent AF who require oral anticoagulant and undergoing PCI, because the risk of a stroke, whether it is paroxysmal or chronic or persistent, is same.
My question is not this. How many people were on anticoagulants before they were going PCI? And how many had developed AF after PCI? Because why I'm saying this, when the patient is on dabigatran, there are issues there are procedural issues, because the hemostasis is a big issue in these patients.
You say clinical procedure. About the procedure, you see, these patients should be done under on radial route. This is recommended. Clinical approach to this kind of patients who is already on oral anticoagulation, whether warfarin or dabigatran or on other NOACs, what you need is a radial access should be the preferred choice. Aspirin should be less than your 100 milligram daily. And clopidogrel should be preferred over prasugrel. No prasugrel at all. And ticagrelor you can give in place of clopidogrel based on redual PCI trial.
One is excess. Second is how will you manage the intra procedural?
No, during procedure you just stop oral anticoagulation 1 day prior and give heparin during the procedure.
But if you go by the duration of action for dabigatran, it takes around 3 days for the dabigatran action to go away.
No, dabigatran is short acting. So 12 hour is the half life. You give twice daily, you know. So you can stop even prior and do the even week. You know, nowadays even we are putting pacemaker. Even people are doing AFib ablation on full dose of NOACs or oral anticoagulation. There is no need to stop it.
Thank you.
Is there any comments from the audience or from the moderators? Okay, with this we close the session. Now
we go on to the next topic. It's expanding role of novel anticoagulants in coronary artery disease, emerging evidence. May I invite Dr. Vishal Rastogi for this deliberation? I think
thank you, Rajneesh. So, I think Dr. R.D. Yadav has very, in great detail, covered most of the aspects of NOACs here. I would be specifically restricting myself to coronary artery disease. We know that coronary artery disease continues to remain a killer worldwide. And it is the 2015 data where a total 56 million deaths were analyzed worldwide, and CAD topped the list in numbers. And this is despite all the advances that we have in the management of these patients. The problem here that we think that the patient who is stable with stable coronary artery disease, he is at lower risk because he is asymptomatic, and or we do a thallium scan and we find no ischemia and we think that patient may not be having any future events. So these patients are very, very heterogeneous group. They may have prior MI, they may have prior bypasses, they just have angina, they may have just myocardial ischemia, which is silent, or may not have any ischemia even. So this is the CLARIFY registry, which was published in 2009. CAD patients who were stable in 45 countries were eligible, and they had to have a stable disease, that means more than 3 months old history of MI or angiographic demonstration of coronary stenosis, chest pain, CABG. And if the patient had CABG or a recent event, then he was excluded. So these are truly all stable patients. And there were 32,700 patients were included. And over a period of 5 years, this is the data that you can see, that 8% of these patients were dead because of any reason. Even 5% patients died of cardiovascular death, and patients who lived also had multiple events throughout these 5 years. So these are not really stable patients. So here also they did the analysis that what are the status of these 32,000 patients, and they found that most of the patients were asymptomatic. They did not have any ischemia or angina. So only 15% patients had ischemia documented on thallium scan, 9% patients had angina, and 11% patients had both ischemia and angina, while 2/3 of the patients did not have any ischemia or any angina symptoms. So they were asymptomatic and without any ischemia. But the event rate, even in these patients who did not have any symptoms, were equal to those patients who had symptoms or who had demonstrable angina. So 70% of the events occurred in patients with no evidence of myocardial ischemia on non-invasive testing, therefore focusing management of stable CAD solely on prevention and treatment of ischemia does not address the risk which is incurred by these patients. So if we can't treat these patients with further angioplasties or bypass surgeries because the risk will remain despite if they're having no ischemia or no symptoms. Similarly, in REACH registry, which was 64,000 patients at 1 year, patients who had just multiple risk factors versus patients who had established disease, the risk was the event cardiovascular events were 3 times more in those patients who had established disease.
But even then, in these established disease patients, if you break up the data, you find that patients who had CAD only versus peripheral arterial disease or versus more than one vascular disease, the risk varied. And you can see those patients who have more than one vascular disease involvement, they fare worse than those patients who have single vascular bed disease. So based on this REACH trial or REACH registry, we can find out those patients who are at higher risk to have further events. So polyvascular disease versus only risk factors, there's two times higher risk of having a further event. Congestive heart failure patients, ischemic events patients, history of diabetes, then all these patients are at higher risk, and we need to look further to manage these patients rather than just using aspirin as a preventive strategy. So what is the rationale of adding anticoagulant to antiplatelet treatment? So platelet activation is a multifactorial factor and mechanism involves thrombin also, because thrombin is a potent platelet agonist and it stimulates platelet activation and aggregation. It also catalyzes the conversion of fibrinogen into fibrin, and it will stabilize the ACS thrombus. Anticoagulant therapy combined with antiplatelet treatment has been shown that it targets complementary mechanism associated with thrombus formation in these patients. So out of these four anticoagulants which are available, which is more suitable for these CAD patients? We know that VKAs are there, which is warfarin and acitrom that we have, dabigatran, rivaroxaban, and apixaban, which are the novel oral anticoagulants. The vitamin K antagonists have their own limitations, and they don't have a predictable response. They require frequent dose adjustment, frequent monitoring. They have a very, very narrow therapeutic window, so not the ideal for a long, long-term use. We have seen that dabigatran, you know, this meta-analysis was found that it had 33% higher risk of MI or ACS in various clinical trials. So dabigatran, there was some issue of worsening of CAD profile in these patients. REDEEM and IPRES 2 trial has been discussed already by Dr. Yadav, but you can see that dabigatran in addition to dual antiplatelet treatment was associated with dose-dependent increase in bleeding events and significantly reduced coagulation activity. Also, apixaban in dose of 5 mg twice daily to antiplatelet treatment in high-risk patients after acute coronary syndrome increased the number of major bleeding without significant reduction in recurrent ischemic events. Rivaroxaban, on the other hand, in ATLAS ACS2 TIMI 51 trial showed benefit in CV death, MI stroke, 16% reduction, mortality reduction, and it is the only EU-approved medicine for post-ACS patients. With this background, the trial was formed, which is the COMPASS trial, and this was for a stable CAD patient. So it was thought that because aspirin is the single most widely used preventive treatment, but it only produces 19% relative risk reduction during the long term. So you need something which confers better benefit. Warfarin with or without aspirin is more effective than aspirin, but increases bleeding risk tremendously, including the intracranial hemorrhage. So you need something which is safer. So rivaroxaban was tried in lower doses as in the TIMI 51 trial. So the objective was to determine the stable CV disease, whether rivaroxaban 2.5 mg BID or plus aspirin 100 mg or rivaroxaban 5 mg BID is better than aspirin alone in reducing the CV risk of stroke, myocardial infarction compared with aspirin. So patients who were tolerating aspirin very well, they were taken into the trial and then randomized to these three arms. The expected follow-up was 3-4 years because they thought that achieve statistical significance, they needed 2,200 events, and they thought that they will be achieved in 3 to 4 years. But, and these were the primary outcomes, CV death, stroke, and myocardial infarction. Secondary outcomes were death, ischemic stroke, myocardial infarction, limb ischemia, mortality, and safety and net clinical benefit outcomes were also included in the study with ICTH, major bleeding, and primary plus fatal or critical organ bleeding. So, In February this year, DSMB had to discontinue because the benefit was far better than the aspirin alone, and it reached a significant p-value. So they had to close down the study at mean follow-up of 23 months only. And these are the primary outcome results. You can see that rivaroxaban plus aspirin versus aspirin, there was a 24% relative reduction of CV death, stroke, and MI. With a very, very significant p-value. These curves start separating very, very early, and they continue to do better in 3 years follow-up. Rivaroxaban and aspirin, they fare much better than aspirin alone. The rivaroxaban alone did not confer that much benefit. So if you break these primary outcomes, there was benefit across all the CV death, stroke, and MI, and it was to the tune of 22%, 42% here, and 16% MI benefit. Secondary outcomes were also better, and the acute limb ischemia, PAD, CHD death, all were better in these patients who were given rivaroxaban in 2.5 milligram twice daily dosages along with aspirin. However, this comes with an increased bleeding risk. And major bleeding, though of course it was the patient had 1.7 times higher risk of major bleeding with the rivaroxaban addition. But the fatal bleeding, non-fatal ICH and non-fatal other bleeding did not reach a statistical significance here. And it was though numerically higher, but did not reach there. So in the trial, the net clinical benefit was inbuilt, the analysis was inbuilt, and when included primary endpoint as well as severe bleeding events, still there was a 20% relative risk reduction in favor of rivaroxaban and aspirin as against aspirin alone with a significant p-value. So to conclude this trial, rivaroxaban 2.5 milligram BID plus aspirin 100 milligrams reduces CV death, stroke, and MI, increases major bleeding without a significant increase in fatal intracranial or critical organ bleeding. It provides a net clinical benefit, and there is no significant benefit of rivaroxaban alone. So I would summarize the data in this one slide, which was by Professor Braunwald in this same meeting, ESC. And till now, we are using aspirin alone in these patients. The efficacy is there, and bleeding risk is very, very low. But still, the benefit is not enough. So CURE showed us that in post-ACS patients, if you use DAPT, the efficacy is much, much higher. And it's recommended to be used. And bleeding is slightly higher, but not too much. In post-ACS patient, we have seen earlier that ASA, if you add warfarin, then efficacy increases, but the bleeding also increases, so it is no longer used strategy now. ATLAS II trial with rivaroxaban in DAPT showed that efficacy increases and bleeding is still not that bad. And now with this COMPASS trial, which is in the stable CAD patient, aspirin along with rivaroxaban 2.5 milligram twice daily has shown tremendous increase in efficacy without much increase in the bleeding risk. Thank you so much.
So I would like to make a comment or two. So you have all the patients who are on rivaroxaban in this trial. They are all stable CAD. So no ACS?
No.
And how many patients underwent revascularization in any form?
So the total risk reduction, if you say, that was the primary endpoint of MI, cardiovascular revascularization, and peripheral arterial disease also, the arm was there. This was to the tune of around 16% relative risk reduction for revascularization as well.
No. My question is this: how many patients who already had a revascularization procedure? Nobody. They had a PCI done?
They had these procedures done more than 3 months prior to enrollment in the trial. So these are stable patients as of today, but may have had, they had to have a documented CAD or a peripheral arterial disease in their previous.
So stable CAD without any procedure?
Yes.
So they neither had angioplasty nor
they might have had procedures in the past.
So how many months back?
3 years ago.
Three months or
years
before.
So how does an ethical committee given not to do a trial in which a DAPT was withdrawn after 3 months?
So that's what I'm saying, that these patients are
three years.
So these are those patients.
3 months.
Yes.
These are those patients who were on aspirin alone, and now you classify.
So these were.
With the issue with the COMPASS values, they have compared aspirin in one arm versus aspirin plus rivaroxaban in the other arm. The real comparison, the second drug we add in stable CAD is a clopidogrel or a P2Y2 inhibitor. They should have compared aspirin plus clopidogrel versus aspirin plus rivaroxaban. Then there will be the true comparison.
No.
Because you've added the second drug in one arm and another drug you haven't added. Usually we add the second drug is clopidogrel, even in stable CAD patients.
If you look,
the data regarding stable CAD, there is no role of dual antiplatelet.
Right.
So there is no sense adding a
so DAPT, these patients did not have any indication for DAPT. They were stable on aspirin patients.
Yeah.
In your usual practice, these are those patients in whom you would just use aspirin and nothing else.
But the basic purpose was to reduce the thrombotic event in stable patients. The second drug after aspirin, we usually add is another. I mean to say the real comparison of the COMPASS trial should be if they had compared rivaroxaban plus aspirin versus aspirin plus clopidogrel. If this, if the arm of rivaroxaban has shown a superiority over aspirin plus clopidogrel, then it would be in a true test.
Can I have one comment? Actually, as far as the aspirin versus aspirin plus clopidogrel part is concerned, it is already, I think, has been tested in many trials, and it has been proven to be ineffective in chronic stable angina because of the reason that the benefit is low and the bleeding risk is high. I think this is the trial which have shown the benefit in chronic stable angina. We are talking about disease.
Not angina.
It's a chronic stable disease. Means that we are talking. We are talking about the chronic stable disease, and the important point in this trial was that the absolute benefit was 0.9% in first year with increased bleeding of 0.9% of major bleeding. So practically the benefit in first year was offset by increase in bleeding. But in second year, I don't know what was the reason, that was the actual query which had been put to the investigators, that why in the second year the risk of bleeding was less, the benefit was similar. So now, from that point of view, that the absolute benefit, of course, it's a chronic stable disease. Chronic stable disease, the benefit will be little low. Actually, that has been the main reason of failure of statin trials and other trials, because the absolute benefit had been little low as compared to the disease. From that point of view, it's an expensive drug. And from my side, if I see from my practice point of view, it looked like that to get an absolute benefit of 0.9% over a year, giving such an expensive drug for a long time and with a excess risk of bleeding based on one trial will be a little difficult.
So the estimate is that if you use, so number needed to treat in this is probably 70 to prevent one event, and they found that because the CAD, stable CAD is such a vast disease, so if you apply this strategy and let's say, you know, there are 40 million patients suffering with CAD and you give it just to 1 or 10% patients, even 10% patients, you'll be able to save 10,000 deaths per year. So that's the, that, you know, if you apply it to a, but yes, I agree with you that the risk of the absolute benefit was 1.4% and the bleeding is 1.3%. Though the bleeding is non-fatal and it was, they calculated in net clinical benefit and they found that the net clinical benefit is still 20%.
You know, what is more ironical is that in the patients who have stable diseases, there was no benefit of having two antiplatelets and you have added an anticoagulant, it is showing a benefit. You know, that is very ironical.
So, last point. You are giving rivaroxaban for secondary prevention in stable patients. Then you need to give, I think, for the lifelong.
Second thing,
there's not a duration.
You never know.
Giving this costly drug for a lifelong, I think.
Yes.
It's not for 1 year, there is 2 years.
So that's
and
why
we need to have
to start a drug.
And second most important.
And that too with some increase in the bleeding. That short bleeding.
Yeah. And
second that's why I showed in REACH registry.
Less will be again still be, I think, around 25-30 rupees.
Second most important thing,
more than 30 rupees.
You never know.
Per tablet, it has to be given twice daily.
Dr. Vishal, good presentation. My only question is, are you using aspirin plus rivaroxaban in your chronic CAD patients?
Not yet.
Second, there is a little confusion about when do you consider after an acute event or after a PCI. Is it after 3 months or is it after 3 years that you,
3 years, these are stable patients who are only on aspirin.
I am asking something else. Yes.
Stable patients who do not need a dual antiplatelet means angioplasty must have been done more than 1 year.
No, sir. There was some confusion.
These were stable patients who did not require a dual antiplatelet means they must angioplasty would have been done at least 1 year prior to the enrollment.
No, sir.
I'm not sure, but there should be.
Like, you know, REACH registry or somewhere.
Yeah, exactly.
Which are still high risk patients.
We need to risk stratify these patients.
Yeah, who would benefit definitely more than the bleeding.
That's a very valid point.
Sir, my
you know, the problem is that.
Sir, my question is different.
were they included after 3 months of an acute event?
That's what I asked.
Yes.
That's what I asked.
No, no.
It is not possible. It is not possible.
There was some confusion.
The slide said 3 months, and what is your take on this?
There's
no slide of 3 months.
Let me complete it. You know, how can you stratify a stable disease? That is a big question, because you are making it a stable disease. So when you are giving a remark that patient is having a stable disease, that means it is a stable disease. The second,
we are getting late.
So let's discuss other things in the lunch, I think. We invite, thank you very much, Dr. Vishal Suri, for a very beautiful lecture. And now I invite Dr. Manish Bansal for the last lecture of this session, the complex subset of heart failure case-based discussion.
Good afternoon, everyone. So my presentation is between you and your lunch. So this is not a very good situation to be in, but I'll try to be concise. This molecule, I believe, has already been discussed in the morning. There was a talk. I was not there, so I'm not sure. The purpose of this session is to just re-emphasize some of the points, some of the scenarios in which it could be beneficial, because the data with this particular, unlike all other new drugs which are coming, this particular molecule has shown absolutely mind-boggling benefit, because for the first time we had a drug which showed more than 20% reduction in all-cause mortality, cardiovascular mortality, on top of ACE inhibitor in HFrEF, which have been gold standard for treatment for HFrEF for almost 25 to 30 years. But there are some challenges, some concerns, which, because of which the medicine is not being used that frequently. One of them is cost, which definitely is a concern, no doubt about that. But apart from that, there should not be any major concern, and that is what I want to discuss. So this is first situation, a patient, 58-year-old, NYHA class 2, EF 35%, blood pressure is fine, 130/84, NT-proBNP is okay, creatinine is also almost all right, borderline, patient has diabetes, and he's already on ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, and spironolactone, plus another diuretic. So he's a stable patient. We see such patients very commonly in our clinical practice. Now he is in NYHA class 2, which means that he is asymptomatic during his routine activity. But if he tries to do anything more than routine, he will become symptomatic. So in true sense, he is a symptomatic patient who is not being symptomatic because he has reduced his activities. And this is a very common situation. So should we switch this patient to ARNI or VIMADA? That is the question. Or should we let it continue on this therapy because he seems to be stable? So what is your opinion about it? Should we switch or should we continue with ACE inhibitor, whatever he is taking? Any show of hands? Would you want to switch to ARNI? Okay. And how many of you would continue to use same ACE inhibitor and would not switch to ARNI? Okay. So Dr. Vishal Rastogi has a different opinion. Okay. So let us go to Paradigm Heart Failure Study, which we know is the main study with these molecules. Now, this is data showing progression of heart failure disease in these patients. So, as we see here, once the patients who were randomized to VIMADA, ARNI, they had less risk of worsening of NYHA class at 4 months, 8 months, and 12 months. So at 1 year, there was 1.3% less absolute risk of worsening of heart failure in the whole group, which included all sorts of patients, right from class 2 to class 4. This is a relatively soft endpoint, worsening of heart failure. This was in addition to the hard endpoint, hard benefits like 20% reduction in the primary endpoint, which was composite of cardiovascular deaths plus hospitalization because of heart failure, and cardiovascular death reduction by 20%, all-cause mortality reduction 16%. So these hard benefits we are already aware, but in addition to that, there was the benefit in terms of reduction in progression of heart failure, which is equally important. And this benefit was seen across all EF groups. So it's not that patients who have very poor LVEF, only they were benefited. Even those who had LVEF above 33%, which means 33 to 40%, they also had the same degree of benefit. What about the potential risk of renal worsening? Because his creatinine was 1.2, patient has diabetes, so he might be having diabetic retinopathy. Now again, if we look at the paradigm heart failure data, worsening in the overall group, worsening of renal function and hyperkalemia were seen less often with Vimada as compared to enalapril. And this was true for all subgroups depending on diabetic status. So from normal, pre-diabetes, new diabetes, or already diabetic patients, in all of them, particularly in diabetic individuals, the risk of renal worsening or hyperkalemia were less with ARNI as compared to enalapril. We know that ARNI reduces blood pressure relatively more as compared to enalapril. In this study, overall, there was 4 to 5 millimeter mercury reduction, millimeters of mercury reduction more with ARNI as compared to enalapril, particularly in those who had higher blood pressure, like 130 to 140. So this patient had 134 by 84 blood pressure. So he will have 4 to 5 millimeter reduction in BP more as compared to enalapril, which is going to be only beneficial in this blood group range, blood pressure range, and will lead to incremental benefit. So the guidelines say that in any patient who is in class 2 heart failure, ARNI is recommended as a replacement for ACE inhibitor to further reduce the risk of heart failure hospitalization and death in patients who are already on ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, and MRA. This is ESC guideline, and ACC/AHA guidelines are same on this. So in particular, in this particular patient who appears to be stable, if we switch to ARNI, this is likely to reduce his symptoms, progression to more severe heart failure, and of course other benefits like mortality reduction and heart failure hospitalization reduction without any concern of renal worsening or worsening of hyperkalemia. So Dr. Vishal, your counter argument about this.
Guidelines both recommend that patient who remains symptomatic on ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, and MRA, they should be shifted to ARNI if they remain symptomatic. So that's the only thing. And you casually mentioned that patient is symptomatic, but because he's not doing activity, that's why he's asymptomatic. So just assess that. If the patient is definitely symptomatic on ACE inhibitor, you should definitely.
Okay, that is agreed.
Because guidelines recommend shifting if patient remains symptomatic on a stable regime of ACE inhibitor.
Yeah, so the
are you talking about guidelines or are you talking about the trial?
Okay, so
good. So let's say
they were not symptomatic. They were stable patients, NYHA class 2.
Perfect.
Okay, so
they were doing fine.
So we discussed this probably.
Okay. So let me just reiterate what has been said. If a patient comes to us, we need to assess his symptomatic status. When we ask him, ki abhi koi abhi aap theek hai, koi problem to nahi hai, saans to nahi phoolta hai. Patient kehta nahi abhi theek hai. We need to assess how active the patient is.
Yes.
Because many a times, the patients who appear to be asymptomatic are actually not asymptomatic. They are in NYHA class 2, which means no symptoms on ordinary activity, but symptoms on anything more than ordinary. If the patient is in NYHA 2, he is likely to derive significant benefits from this therapy. And it is our responsibility to truly assess that.
Yes.
If before assuming that the patient is NYHA 1.
We are not giving ARNI for symptomatic relief. We are giving ARNI to prevent sudden cardiac death. We are giving ARNI to prevent mortality. We are giving ARNI to prevent rehospitalization. We are not giving for symptomatic relief. So even in asymptomatic patients with stable NYHA class 2, when giving this therapy, can we give an advantage of all these?
Okay, so
three?
Just
given a choice.
Just to answer
it's
this.
It's not a symptomatic relief.
No. just to answer this.
Is symptomatic.
No. Okay.
Pankaj, you don't treat patients based on a very, very selected group of patients in a trial. Either you use medicine based on multiple trials, or you just use it as prescribed in that trial. You have to have a run-in phase where you give these patients whether they tolerate both ARNI and both ACE inhibitor, and then you later on shift to ARNI. So you have to go according to trials.
So Dr. Vishal, I'll just summarize this. What he is saying, see, class 2 means symptomatic.
But they're doing fine with
this. It's not asymptomatic. Uh-huh. And we are not giving this for reduction of symptoms.
Yeah.
As you said, it is for greater benefits. Only thing is that class 2 is not asymptomatic. So we are not supposed to use this therapy for class 1 patients because it's not been tested in them. So class 2, but most of our patients who come to us in OPD are actually in class 2. That is what I want to emphasize. We should not consider them to be in class 1. We'll move to the next case because of the paucity of time. Another patient, he is a relatively sicker patient, EF 30%, blood pressure is 100/75, and NT-proBNP is 1200, which is high. Creatinine 1.2, and same therapy, on background therapy. So now, see, this patient has NT-proBNP, which is 1200 picogram per ml, which actually identifies this patient as at high risk of having adverse events. So this again is data from the paradigm heart failure trial. If you look at patients below or more than 1000 nanogram picogram per ml cutoff for NT-proBNP, those who had higher NT-proBNP, they had much worse outcome. So this patient is high risk for having worse outcomes in future, even though he appears to be relatively stable right now. Now, in such patients, when ARNI was added, ARNI led to greater reduction in NT-proBNP because of improvement in heart failure, and more patients reached less than 1000, less than 750, and less than 500 picogram per ml levels of NT-proBNP. And in all subgroups, benefits were seen almost to the same extent as overall population in terms of hard endpoint reduction. Now, there's concern about hypotension in this patient because blood pressure is 100/75. There's no doubt that ARNI will lead to greater reduction in BP. Symptomatic hypotension is more common, but there was no difference in drug discontinuation because of hypotension in paradigm heart failure. So we need not worry that much worry about it. Secondly, even if there's reduction in blood pressure, patient becomes symptomatic, we can down titrate the medication. In fact, almost half of the patients in paradigm heart failure also received less than target dose of blood pressure because less than target dose of ARNI. Because of the same reason, they developed hypotension, dose was reduced. But importantly, the benefit was same in those who received target dose versus those in whom dose was reduced because of hypotension. So they also achieved same degree of benefit as the whole group of population. So in this patient also, we need not worry about hypotension. We need to monitor blood pressure. If patient is becoming symptomatic, we reduce the dose. If the patient remains symptomatic, only then we should discontinue it, because even low dose of ARNI will lead to benefit compared to enalapril. And third and final situation is similar type of patient, but potassium 5 millimole per liter, which is very common in these patients because of ACE inhibitor. There is hyperkalemia, there is renal dysfunction, which leads to hyperkalemia. Now we want to add spironolactone, which is class 1 agent in HFrEF, but we are not able to add because of risk of worsening of hyperkalemia. So what do? We let the patient be on ACE inhibitor only, or we switch to ARNI and try to add MRA. So again, going back to paradigm heart failure data, the risk of rise in potassium was much less with ARNI as compared to enalapril. Significantly less, actually. And this benefit was seen irrespective of whether patients were already on MRA, whether MRA was not there, or whether MRA was added later on during the trial. So if we add spironolactone during the trial to the patient's treatment, if we add ARNI instead of ACE inhibitor, we are more likely to be able to continue both drugs and less likely to stop one of these drugs because of hyperkalemia, which becomes a common reason, a common challenge in these patients. So in this patient, replacing an ACE inhibitor with ARNI or VIMATA will reduce the risk of hyperkalemia, will enable addition of MRA, and both these agents have been shown to reduce mortality significantly, so will likely lead to greater benefits. So these are the three scenarios which I wanted to highlight, which are very common in our daily clinical practice and which are some of are often the reasons why we fail to switch the patients from ACE inhibitor to ARNI. Thank you.
Dr. Bansal, tell me one thing. Yeah, here, Dr. Ankit, on the right of you.
Sorry.
what is more fascinating about heart failure is that the patients are already having very high levels of BNP.
Yeah.
And in fact, you monitor this patient by BNP. Why you require more natriuretic peptides?
Pardon
me? My point. You are having so much of BNP, thousands, 1500, 2000s, and you still require, you have to replace, you have to give more BNP. Why it is so? Do you think it is just like insulin resistance, that you have insulin, but the insulin is not working?
No.
Do you know any data regarding this? Because you have so much BNP.
See, actually, these patients, they have their high levels of NT-proBNP or natriuretic peptides are because of heart failure syndrome, because they are not compensated.
So that is a counter-regulatory mechanism the body has developed. You know?
So we, exactly. So here, we are not giving natriuretic peptide alone. We are giving valsartan plus natriuretic peptide,
right,
which will together lead to reduction in heart failure.
No. It is why you have
added, he mean to say why you have naproxen inhibitor, because these vasoactive peptides, they are degraded automatically. To prevent the degradation, we give naproxen inhibitor so that the concentration increases.
That is why. That is what I'm telling you. What he's telling, you know, there is already a very high level of natriuretic peptides in body, and you are just increasing the mean plasma level of this by inhibiting the enzymes which degrade it, right? First thing, why you are adding an angiotensin receptor blocker to this? The reason is that if you give only naproxen inhibitor, it blocks the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. So there is a very increased amount of angiotensin 1 in the body. So you require a concomitant.
Yes, exactly. So this combination will lead to improvement in overall neuromedullary control of heart failure, and that will lead to eventual reduction in NT-proBNP level.
Yes, acutely you cannot give alone, yes.
Yes.
And the reason that even though the BNP is very high in these patients, they still require a higher BNP to give the desired amount. That's why you have to give a naproxen inhibitor. There was a trial, neseritide recombinant BNP they have used, but it was a negative trial.
Because whenever they are used alone, they have failed.
No, it has not failed because of this. It has failed because it was an intravenous drug.
No, that's true, but even oral drug was also tried.
Acute heart failure not for chronic heart failure, yes. That was omaprazole, which was with ACE inhibitor, and that was a very high incidence of angioedema.
Because ACE,
that's why it was withdrawn.
We must remember, if ACE inhibitor is already in the therapy, we need to stop it and wait for at least 36 hours before adding ARNI.
So one last comment from you. Any patients you did an echo, symptomatic, asymptomatic, and the echo was found to be having an EF of 35%. Will you go ahead and give ARNI? So ACE, ARB or ARNI, would you give this as a class 1 indication?
See, actually, the guideline currently mentions using ARNI as a substitute for ACE inhibitor. But given the data, I would be inclined to use ARNI as the first line therapy. Only thing which holds me is cost, which is a major challenge in our patients.
Dr. Vishal, your take on this?
I think so. Already many people are out, they're having lunch. We should look at our BNP levels.
Thank you very much.
So let's disperse for a lunch to reassemble here in an hour or so to have the follow-up sessions. Thank you.
Thank you.